Everyone, very warm welcome to the session. All right, so today we are going to see a very important topic. Yes, okay, fine. So we are going to see about your enzyme as well as the inhibition, no, that is pertaining to your concepts. All right, so this is about me. So my Nidhi, you know, you already know me. Yes, Sonali, Vijaydirka, Jyotishmita, Nupur. All right, good everyone, happy to see that all. Right, fine. So I am Dr. Sanya. I have already completed my PhD in biomaterials, right? Okay, so let us begin our today's section with your enzymes. All right, so what are your enzymes? These enzymes are nothing but they are going to be your biomolecules, right? So they are going to help in a reaction, right? So what they will do, they are going to increase the rate of reaction, okay, right? And do these enzymes, they will help. Oh yes, everyone, very good afternoon all, happy to meet you all back, right? Okay, so will these enzymes, they will try to change the rate of the reaction? Do you think so? Never. They are not going to change the equilibrium, right? But they will change only, or they will increase only the rate of the reaction. I used to compare the steps with the elevator, right? Yeah, so both of them, they will start from the ground floor and they are going to move up to the first floor, right? Okay, fine. So if you take the step, you have to spend a lot of energy and you have to climb, right? But you are not going to climb from the first to the ground. You are moving from the ground to the first floor, right? But if at all you are using this elevator, what this elevator is going to do? As all, the elevator is making it to be very easy, no? You need not spend your energy. You have to simply stand on the elevator. That's it, isn't it? So it will keep on moving, isn't it? Absolutely, guys. Right, right. Yes, all, very happy. Fine. So that is how your elevator is going to take you to the next floor. Right? Absolutely. Fine. So that is what this is happening with your enzyme. The enzyme is not going to change the rate, it is not going to change the order, okay? From the ground floor only, it is taking you through the first floor, right? Yeah, yes, Yusuf, absolutely. So this escalator or the elevator or the lift, it is going to carry you from the ground floor to the first floor, right? Yes, everyone, very happy. Fine, so it is not moving in the reverse direction and all. But what it will do, it will increase the speed of the reaction, isn't it? So while climbing the steps, it may take 1 minute time. But if you take a lift or an escalator, you are going to reach the spot in just 20 seconds, maybe in 30 seconds, yes? So that is what it is, the speed of the reaction, okay? But the direction is not changed, only the speed is going to get changed. All right, fine. So what are these enzymes? These enzymes, they are your biological molecules that are speeding up the reaction within the cell, right? Okay, so now you have different integral part of your enzyme. What are they? We will do up with the basic definition one more time. Right. Number one, you are going to contain this holoenzyme. All right. What do you mean by holo? Holo is the total or the whole unit, isn't it? Yeah. So that whole unit is called as your holoenzyme. Okay. So what are the component of your holoenzyme? Yes. So the component, it is going to include. Yeah. It is including the cofactor. What do you mean by cofactor? Along with that whole unit, you have something that is appending. Yeah. So what is that appending factor called? If at all it is going to be an inorganic substance, then you call them as a cofactor. right? Okay, so what is a cofactor? Cofactor is nothing but it is an inorganic component. So what are the common examples of the inorganic component? Yes, so it is going to include your ferric, Fe2+, Mg2+, Mn2+, Zn2+, right? So all of them, they are going to come under your cofactor, right? Then what is your coenzyme? Huh? So coenzyme, all right. Oh yes, Yusuf. Yes, somehow it got on. All right. Yes. Notification is getting on, Yusuf. I don't know how to off it. Yes. Okay. Maybe in the next session I'll try to do that. All right. Fine. Yeah. So coming to this coenzyme, right? Okay. So this coenzyme, this is, you know, going to be an organic component. Okay. So if at all this component is going to be inorganic, it is called as the cofactor. Okay, so if at all it is going to be an organic one, then you call it as a coenzyme. Yes, you got the difference between what is a coenzyme? Yes, you said. What is a coenzyme and what is going to be the cofactor? All right, fine. Yes. So, my God. Sorry, guys. Just a moment. Okay. I don't know. Sorry. Right. Fine, guys. I don't know to mute it. Just a moment. I'll just try it out. Okay, guys. Just hold for a moment. I'll just try to, off it off. Yes, everyone. All right, fine. I think now it is clear. Okay, guys. Sorry for the interruption. Somehow it got on. All right. Yes. Right. Yeah, fine, guys. So I think it went. Okay, good. Right. Coming back. Yeah. I found it now. Right. So what is an enzyme? So this enzyme, it is helping to increase the rate of the reaction, and it is not affecting your equilibrium. All right. Fine. Yes. Thanks a lot, everyone, for your patience. Yes. So it is not affecting the equilibrium. In the meanwhile, if you take the enzyme, you have this holoenzyme, right? And then you have the components. The component, you call it as a cofactor. Yes. And then you call it as a coenzyme. So when you call it as a cofactor, yeah, so whenever you are using your inorganic elements, what are the inorganic elements? Probably, you know, Fe2+, yes, probably Mn2+, all your inorganic ions, they make up your cofactor, right? What is going to be the coenzyme? Coenzyme is nothing but it is going to make off with your organic component. Yes. So this organic component, that is going to include your NAD, your THF. Yes. All of them, they are the organic component. Right. So they will form the part of the coenzyme. You get a term called prosthetic group. What do you mean by this prosthetic group? The prosthetic group, it can be a cofactor or it can be a coenzyme. But what will happen? Yes. So this cofactor or the coenzyme, whichever it is, whenever it is very tightly and covalently bound, it is called as the prosthetic group. All right. So I hope that this is all clear. We will make it one more final time with the definitions. Right. So what are the property? THF is tetrahydrofolate. Okay. Right. So what are the properties of your enzyme? So the enzymes, they are going to catalyze your reaction. Yes. Right. So think of your elevator. It is going to increase the reaction, rate of the reaction. Okay. But it will not form. Yes. So it is not going to change the direction. Okay. So this direction is not altered. All right. Fine. So it is not altered. Okay. And what about the second property we saw? We saw it a holoenzyme. Holoenzyme means it is going to include your enzyme along with your cofactor or your coenzyme. Everything put together, the whole unit is called as the holoenzyme. Yes. And what about your cofactor? Cofactor means it is only going to be your inorganic component, isn't it? The inorganic component, it is what is called as the cofactor. So the examples may be the metal ions Mn2 plus, yes, Fe2 plus, and then all these metal ions, they are going to be called as your cofactor. Yes, any kind of inorganic ions, right? Absolutely. And what about your coenzyme? If you take your coenzyme, it is going to be an organic component, isn't it? Yeah, inorganic Mn2 plus is there, absolutely. And organic, you take your tetrahydrofolate, yes, you take your NAD, you take your FAD, right? So all these, they are going to be your organic component, right? So together they are making up your enzyme, right? And yes, yeah, so what is going to help out? So what is going to help out in your prosthetic group? So this prosthetic group, yes, this is a covalently bound, right? So this can be your coenzyme or it can be your cofactor, right? So they are very tightly and they are covalently bound. So that is what is called as your prosthetic group. Alright, so I hope that this is all clear. Right, okay, fine. Yes, and what are the other terms that you should be aware of? Yes, number one, it is going to be the active site. Yeah, so if you take your enzyme, you may contain many sites, right? But one of these sites is called as the active site. What do you mean by active site? This is the site where exactly the catalysis is taking place, right? So whenever your substrate is coming and binding with this site, this is acted by your enzyme and it will get converted into your product. That site is called as the active site. So what do you call this site as? Yes, what is this site? It is an other site, no? What is that called as? It is an allosteric site, isn't it? Absolutely. So your active site, it is the catalytic site. All the other sites, they are the allosteric sites. Okay, absolutely. Yes, they are the allosteric site. Very good. And what about your substrate? Your substrate molecule, it can, absolutely, it can bind with your active site and it will be acted upon. So that will be get converted into your product. Right. And very often you hear this term KM. What is this KM? KM is your Michael Mendelian's constant, no? KM, right? So what is this KM? It is nothing but it is your substrate concentration whenever your Bmax is half. So see here, this is how your reaction is moving, no? Right, so this is your Vmax, right? So at one point your Vmax will be half, right? So this is Vmax by 2. This is your substrate, this is your velocity, right? Okay, so this is the velocity V, this is the substrate. So this is your Vmax half. So the exact concentration, absolutely, yes, Srijan. So the exact concentration when your Vmax is half, that concentration is what is called as the KM. Okay, right. So KM, it is the substrate concentration at half Vmax. Okay, so what do you call this V0? V0, it is the initial velocity. Initially it will be 0, no? That is the initial rate of the velocity, right? And then what is the Vmax? It is your maximal velocity. That is called as your Vmax. Alright, so this is a very important table. So it is telling you about the list of coenzyme as well as, you know, what group they are going to transfer. Okay, right, yes. So the first one, it is your biocytin. Okay, right. So this biocytin, it is going to transfer your CO2, right? A very important enzyme, biocytin. So from where it is derived? this is derived from your biotin. Okay, so this biotin, it is giving rise to this biocytin. So this is a very important coenzyme that is going to transfer your CO2. All right, fine. The second important one, it is the coenzyme A. So what this coenzyme A, it is going to transfer? Do you know? So this coenzyme A, it is going to transfer the acyl group. Very important. So biocytin, it is going to transfer your CO2. Your coenzyme A, it is going to transfer the acyl group. All right. And the third important one, I'll tell you only the important ones. FAD, flavin adenine dinucleotide, FAD. So that is going to transfer your electron. All right. So FAD, it is going to transfer your electron. All right. Fine. The fourth important one that you should study is NAD. All right. Yes. So what is this NAD going to transfer as a coenzyme? It is going to transfer your H+. That is a hydride ion. All right. Okay. NAD, it is going to transfer your hydride ion. Very good. And next, your pyridoxal phosphate. Okay. This is different and your TPP is different. Okay. Right. PP, it is going to be your pyridoxal phosphate. That is going to transfer your amino group. All right. So your pyridoxal phosphate, it is going to transfer your amino group. Very important. TPP, very important fellow, it is your thiamine pyrophosphate, right? The thiamine pyrophosphate, it is going to transfer the aldehyde, very important, aldehyde. Thiamine pyrophosphate, it is going to transfer the aldehyde. One more fellow, it is your THF. Yes, this THF, it is going to transfer your one carbon, okay? So these seven are very important. So shall we just recap one more time? What about your biocytin? Biocytin with the CO2. Bio and CO2. Okay, right. And then coac, right? So your coenzyme A with your acyl group, right? And then FAD. Yes, what is FAD? FAD, electron. So bio CO2, so the biology class, they are preparing a carbonated drink. So bio CO2, so they are adding coca. Okay, so COAAC, COCAC. Okay, so they faded. So this carbonated drink was not good. So they all faded, right? Yeah, so it is FAD. Fine, what is next? NADH, right? So you will remember NAD and H+, NADH. Right. So they just made a PAP. Okay. So your pyridoxal phosphate, it is your amino group. Okay. So they were calling this AM. Yes, Nupur. So this PAPAM. Okay. So PAPAM. So pyridoxal phosphate, it is the amino group. PAPAM. Right. And then, so yes. So TPP, aldehyde. Okay. So what clue you can give for this TPP? So they were started to tap. Okay, so you remember tap, right? So TPP, aldehyde. TPP is aldehyde. Okay, finally THF is one carbon. Okay, right. So this is a very, very important table. For sure you will get questions. Already twice this question has come. Not once, twice it has come for 4 marks. Yes. So shall we take up this question? It is going to be very easy for you all, I guess. Yes, absolutely good. So some coenzymes, they serve as a transient carriers of specific chemical groups that are shown below. All right. Number one, it is the coenzyme A. Number two, it is the flavin adenine dinucleotide. Yes. Number C, it is going to be your pyridoxal phosphate. Number D, it is your nicotinamide adenine dinucleotide. All right. Yes. And here you have your electrons, acyl group, hydride and amino group. Right. So what was the clue? COCAC, no? So they were adding COCO, no? Coenzyme A, it is your acyl group. Yes, everyone. And they faded, no? FAD is E, fade, right? So COCAC and fade. So A is 2, right? So by A is 2 only, you could have found that B is the answer, isn't it? Right. And your B is going to be 1, correct. Yeah, and C. Papam, they were making the noise like papam, right? Okay, so pyridoxal phosphate, it is with the amino group. Yeah, and finally NADH, right? Yeah, so the correct answer is going to be option B. 4 marks for this very simple table, and this was a repeated question also, isn't it? All right, very good all. Yes, so now we have come to another important portion. It is your MM equation. Yeah, so this MM equation is nothing but your Michael-Mendelian equation. So before understanding into Michael-Mendelian equation, yes, all right, yes, yes, it will be coming, don't worry, right? So this Michael-Mendelian equation, this is about how your enzymes know it is going to behave. So what is in this x-axis? It is the substrate, right? And what is in the y-axis? It is your velocity, isn't it? Right. So now what happens? Your enzyme, it is going to start up, right? You can note it that in your first order reaction, yes, so in the first order reaction, whenever you increase the concentration, you take it as 0, 5, 10, 15, okay, till this, right? This is the first order. So if you are increasing the concentration from 0 to 5, what happens to the velocity? It is increasing or it is the same? The velocity is increasing, isn't it? So that is why this is called as the first order kinetics or the first order reaction. In the first order reaction, the rate is directly proportional to the substrate concentration. All right, fine. But after some point, a plateau is reached. Yeah, so once it is reaching a plateau, yes, will it be dependent on your substrate concentration? See, I put it as 15, 20, 25, 30. Even it is 20, it is the same. Even it is 25, it is the same. Bear with me. 30 also, it is the same. Yeah. So after reaching the plateau, it is depending not on your substrate, right? So it depends only on your enzyme, right? So these two points you have to remember. Okay, so whenever this is dependent on your substrate, you call it as the first order kinetics. Whenever it is becoming zero order, it is not dependent on the substrate, but only on your enzyme. Right. So what is your MM equation? MM equation says that your V naught is equal to V max into S by Km plus S. All right. Yes. So now you know what is V max. V max, it is going to be the maximum velocity. Okay, right. And what is your S? Yes, it is going to be, absolutely. Yes, it is going to be your substrate concentration, isn't it? Right. So that is your substrate concentration. Very good. And what about your Km? Yes. So what is Km? Very good. Yes, everyone. So Km is nothing but it is representing your Michael-Mendelian's constant. Okay. So it is a constant. Absolutely. Oh, don't worry. We can pick it up. Right. So it is a constant. So what is the definition for this constant? Shall we see before seeing this thing? All right. So this Km, it is equal to K2 plus K minus 1 by K1. Right. Okay. So how did we derive at this? It is K2 plus, this K minus 1 plus K1. How did we get it? We will just write a direct equation. It will be easy for you. E plus S, it is going to give you enzyme substrate complex. Okay. So this is going to form your enzyme along with the product. Right. So this is a very, very direct equation. So your enzyme and the substrate, it is going to react and it is going to form your enzyme substrate complex, and then it is forming your enzyme plus product. Okay, so what is this constant here? It is your K1, isn't it? Right. So K1, it is telling about how your E and S is associating and forming your ES. Right. Okay. And what is K-1? It is telling how your ES is splitting and coming back to E and S form. All right. And what is your K2? K2 is nothing but it is the conversion of your ES into E and P. Right. So now coming to your Km. Do you remember the formula for K equilibrium? Yes. What is K equilibrium? The dissociation constant. Always it will be the product by the reactant, isn't it? Right. Always, no, it is the B by A, right? So you call it as B by A, isn't it? So if it is A plus B, you will call them as B by A. All right. Yes. So coming back here, now you want to find out the Km. Km, it is the dissociation and association constant, isn't it? Right. So which one will come at the top? It is the dissociation, isn't it? Right. So ES is dissociating, no, in two manner. One, it can be this. One, it can be this, no. So your Km is equal to K2 plus K-1 by K1. Got it? Yes. So now you got it. How you got this formula? K2 plus K-1 by K1. All right. So this is a very basic thing, but still, no, you need to understand that. Okay. So if at all your enzyme is following your MM equation, it will form a hyperbolic curve. Okay. So it is going to form a hyperbolic curve. All right. So if at all it is not following your hyperbola, it is going to be your allosteric enzyme. So what do you mean by allosteric? I told you that it is not going to act on your, it is not going to act on your catalytic site. All right. Oh, thank you, Lord. Thank you, Rishali. Instead of this catalytic site, what it is? It is going to act on some other site. Right. So this some other site, it is what it is called as your allosteric site, isn't it? Right. So if at all your enzyme is acting on a hyperbolic method, right, it is going to be, yes Manju, it is going to be your normal enzyme. But if at all it is an allosteric enzyme, it is not following your MM equation. All right, I hope that this is all clear. So we'll take up a question now. Fine. Right. So part B, only 2 marks. Right. Very quickly we will do this question. Choose the incorrect statement from the following. All right. The kinetic properties of your allosteric enzymes, they do not diverge from your MM behavior. Yes, just think. Absolutely. Good, everyone. Right. So the next option, it says that, in a feedback inhibition. Right. Okay. Yes, absolutely, Yusuf. The feedback inhibition, the product is inhibiting your enzyme pathway. All right. So that should be true only. Right. This is not an incorrect one. This is a correct one, isn't it? Right. What about this first statement? This is an incorrect one, isn't it? So this is the correct answer for us. Yeah. Why? Because I told you that the kinetic properties of the allosteric, they are diverging from your Michael Mendelian. Your Michael Mendelian, it shows that it is going to be a hyperbola, but your allosteric, it is a sigmoid. So that is going to diverge off, isn't it? So that is going to be the correct answer. Alright, anyhow, we will just go through the other options also. An antibody that is binding tightly with your analog. Yes, so it is going to make them in an intermediate reaction. So that will promote the formation of P. Absolutely, that is a correct statement. And your enzyme with your K-cat is given. What is K-cat? Yeah, So what is KCAT? Catalysis KCAT. It is nothing but it is telling about the turnover number. Yes, it is very closely related to your turnover number and KCAT. All right. Yes, yes, absolutely. Right. And the KM, it has a activity which is close to the diffusion control. So that is also a correct statement. Absolutely. So it is your Vmax by E, no? Absolutely. Right, right. So that is going to be a very, very correct answer. So in the question, they have asked for your incorrect answer. So your option A is going to be very directly incorrect. Right. So what is this KCAT? Huh? This KCAT is nothing but it is the turnover number, no? Yeah, per unit time. So in general, we know that your Vmax is equal to KCAT of the enzyme, right? And definitely, no, if you want to calculate the KCAT, KCAT is equal to Vmax by E. Absolutely, you are all right. And then you, what is your KM? KM is your Vmax by 2. So these two formulas, definitely you should know, understand, right? And one more important graph, apart from your MM equation, yeah, so one more important point to be understood. What is that? It is your Lyon-Weber-Berg equation. Absolutely important for your exam. See, if at all in your exam, they are asking which is better. Huh? Your MM is better or Lyon-Weber-Berg equation is better. Which is better? Very good, Nivedita. Your Lyon-Weber-Berg plot is still better than your MM. Yes, it is going to still more give a very, very precise information. Yeah, so this Lyon-Weber-Berg plot, it is a reciprocal reaction. So for your MM equation, you know that your, yes, for your MM equation, you know that, what is that formula? Vmax, yes, do you remember the formula? Vmax into, come on. So what is your MM equation? It says that your Vmax into, yes, by Km plus S. You remember that? Vmax into S by Km plus S. So that is what is V naught, isn't it? Here you are going to take a reciprocal. So here you are going to take up a reciprocal, right? So what you are going to do? You are going to take 1 by V naught, right? Absolutely. So you are taking your 1 by V naught is equal to Km by Vmax plus S plus 1 by Vmax, because you are taking reciprocal, na? So you will be getting this equation. This is what is called as your Lyon-Weber-Berg plot, right? Okay. So now you are going to plot your 1 by S versus 1 by V naught. One more thing, you should be very careful with the units. So if you take your V naught, your unit will be micromolar per minute, right? So now this is 1 by V naught. So it is going to be 1 by micromolar per minute. Yeah, absolutely. But these units you have to remember. What about S? S, it will be given in the millimolar. Okay, so 1 by S is 1 by millimolar. All right, absolutely. Then you are going to get a slope. What is a slope? This is what is called as a slope, no? Right. So the slope is nothing but Km by Vmax. Yes, absolutely. So what is the slope? It is your Km by Vmax. Okay. And then now you are getting this equation. And where is your Km intersecting? I mean, where is your this line of your Vmax? Wherever it is intersecting with your S, that becomes your 1 by Km. Okay. Right. Absolutely. So this is your LB or Lyon-Weber-Berg plot equation, right? So now coming to the next important subtopic for the day, it is on your inhibition, right? So you want to inhibit. Yes, absolutely. Yes, Sumaya, this is a 1 hour class, right? Okay, so half we have done with the enzyme. Now we are going to do continue it up with your inhibition, right? Yeah, yes, yes. So this month we are doing as a 1 hour session, okay? Right. Yes, everyone, come on, cheer up. Okay, so the next one I told you is your inhibition. So there are different types of inhibition. It can be a reversible inhibition, it can be an irreversible inhibition, okay? So where this inhibition is coming to play a role? This inhibition, it is helpful in the treatment. isn't it? So you used to treat for disease, right? Yeah, so all these treatments, they use your enzyme inhibition. So they are of different types, like reversible, irreversible. And then again, you can subdivide them into your competitive inhibition, non-competitive inhibition, uncompetitive inhibition, right? Even you have this mixed inhibition, right? Yes, okay. So all these different types are there, right? So very briefly, we will just have a look at it one by one. Yes, so in case of this competitive inhibition, you have an active site, yes? So the same active site, it is being competed by your substrate as well as by your inhibitor. So what will happen? Either your substrate can win or your inhibitor can win, isn't it? So both at a time they cannot sit, yes? So it can be either your substrate or your inhibitor, right? So it will be either E plus S or it is going to be E and I, isn't it? Right, so that is how it is looking here. Fine. So in case of the non-competitive inhibition, so in non-competitive inhibition, what is happening is that your substrate, it will bind to the active site, right? Okay. Your inhibitor, it is binding somewhere else. So this is called as which site? So this is not an active site. So what this site is called as? Yes, everyone, can you see that? Your substrate is not binding with your active site. Your inhibitor is not binding with your active site. So what it is called as? What that additional one is called as, do you know? That is what it is called as, your allosteric site. Very good, Srijan, Nivedita, Anjali. So this is what is called as your allosteric site. Absolutely. Yes, Rishali. Yes, Preeti. So yes, Anjali. So that is going to be your allosteric site, neighbor site, no? Right, right. Yes, Disha. Yes, Nupur. Very good. So here there is no direct competition, right? But remember, if this inhibitor is binding to this allosteric site, it is making a conformational change, okay? So see, the shape of your active site is changing. Right? Yeah, Preetam, very good. It is an allosteric site. So now this shape is changed. Can now this substrate bind? Can this substrate can now bind to this altered site? No, it cannot bind. Yes? So this is what this inhibition is doing. It is a non-competitive inhibition. Okay? Right. Fine. So this can be like your non-competitive inhibition. Absolutely, everyone. Yes, Preeti, Preetam, Srijan, Rishali, and Anjali. Good. Fine. So the next inhibitor, it is your uncompetitive inhibition. So what do you mean by uncompetitive? See, this is not competing with your substrate. This is binding. In fact, after this is bound, only this substrate is coming and binding. Right? So this is forming your E plus I already, enzyme and inhibitor, and to that, yes, Parvati, so to that only your substrate is coming and binding. I will show you a table so you will understand it better, right? Yeah, so in case of your competitive inhibition, it is like either ES or EI, okay? Right, in case of your non-competitive, it is like it can be an enzyme, substrate and inhibitor. Okay, so it can be your E and I. So this EI, it is like your competitive inhibitor. Also, it can be like your EIS. So this is like your uncompetitive. So what is the name of your non-competitive? Do you know? See, one way it can behave like your E and I alone will bind. Okay, sometime it is like ES and I can bind. So what is the type of this inhibitor? It is called as mixed inhibitor. Why mixed? Did you get the point? I'll tell you one more time. All right. See here, your non-competitive inhibitor. Okay. Yes. So non-competitive inhibitor, it has your enzyme. Okay, right. Yes. So it has an enzyme, right? And it is having a site. Okay. So this is going to be your active site. So to this only your substrate is binding, right? You have one more site to which your inhibitor is binding. So what are the permutation and combination in non-competitive? Either your enzyme can directly bind with your inhibitor, right? Yes, Anjali. So your non-competitive, it is what is called as your mixed inhibitor. Why it is a mixed inhibitor? See here, your enzyme can react with your inhibitor and it can behave like your competitive manner, isn't it? See, it is behaving like your competitive manner. Also, your enzyme can bind with your substrate as well as your inhibitor. So it forms this ESI complex. So this is like your uncompetitive inhibitor, isn't it? So this is called as, absolutely Rishali. So both can bind. So it is called as your mixed inhibitor. Got the point? Okay, absolutely. Competitive and uncompetitive, both it can act as. Right? So EI also can bind, ESI also it can bind. But this competitive, it is only EI. Okay? This uncompetitive, it is always ESI. So if this S is not bound, then your this fellow can never interact with your enzyme. Okay? So in case of your uncompetitive, it always demands the presence of S. Without yes, Anjali, that's great. So without yes, it cannot bind. That is why this is called as your uncompetitive inhibitor. Yes, everyone, I hope that this is all clear to you. What is a competitive inhibitor? What is a non-competitive inhibitor? And what is going to be the uncompetitive inhibitor? Okay, so we will see one more time in detail explanation with reference to your Vmax and Km and all. Alright, so this is what it is happening in your competitive inhibition. Yes, so this is competing for your active site. Right, so whenever it is coming and binding, very good all. Yes, so whenever it is coming and binding with your active site, so this becomes a competitive inhibitor. Okay, so this will reduce the efficiency of the enzyme. And what type of binding it is? It is a reversible binding. Okay, so this competitive inhibitor is reversible. So what you can do, if at all you increase the substrate concentration, see your substrate is 100 in number, your inhibitor it is only 10 in number, right? So you have your enzyme that is 20. Who will win this competition? Yes, substrate is 100, inhibitor is 10, your enzyme is 20. So who will win? Whether your substrate will win or inhibitor will win? Only your substrate is going to win. Why? Because it is more in number. Got it? Right. Yes, absolutely. Yes, Diksha. Yes, Rishali. So the substrate is going to win. So your ES will be formed. Isn't it? Right. Absolutely. Right. So that is what this inhibitor, it is binding reversibly. So how you can overcome? You put increase amount of substrate, it can be overcome. Yes, absolutely. Right. So there is going to be no inhibition. This is why this is called as a reversible inhibition. Alright. So what will happen in case of this competitive inhibition? You have the same Vmax, but your Km is increased. Same Vmax, but what happens? Your Km is increased. Km is increased, it is good or bad? Km, it is inversely proportional to the affinity. Okay, so if Km is increased, you need more amount to be put. So that is not good, right? Okay, but you can see that from this graph that for your competitive inhibition, your Vmax is same, right? Yeah, it is very bad only, right? But your Km, it is increasing, right? So your Km is increased here, absolutely. But if you compare the non-competitive inhibition, the inhibition is still more. See the rate of the reaction, this much it is reduced. See, this is 0, 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, you keep, okay? So your competitive inhibition is little bit less only. So even after you add the inhibitor also, the rate of the reaction is maintained at 70. You got my point. But what about the non-competitive inhibitor? Yes, non-competitive inhibitor is almost decreasing to 40, no? Right? Uncompetitive also it is decreasing. The Vmax is decreasing. You got it? Right. So this is a very important information. So your Vmax, it is decreasing in both the things, in your non-competitive and uncompetitive. But in case of your competitive inhibition, your Vmax is the same. But your KM is increased in your competitive inhibitor, and your KM is same in your non-competitive inhibitor, and KM is again increased in case of your uncompetitive inhibitor. Got it? Okay. So the best example for the competitive inhibitor, it is going to include your malonoic acid. Okay. So with whom this malonoic acid fellow is competing? He is competing with the succinate. Where you have studied this? In Krebs cycle? Yes, you have studied this Krebs cycle. You have studied this succinate dehydrogenase. You have studied the succinate. You have studied this malonoic acid. Yes? Okay. Now you remember that? Alright. So this is going to be with your competitive inhibition. Right? Yeah, absolutely everyone. Yes, yes, with the Krebs cycle only. Yes, Regen, Yusuf, Nivedita, Nipur, very good all. So this is with your, yes, Vrishali, yes, Ruchi, absolutely. So this is with your competitive inhibition. So this malonoic acid, this is competing your succinate, right? Absolutely. Succinate for your this thing. So this is a very good example of your competitive inhibition. Right. So likewise, you have many examples today. We will just see these basic things alone. All right. And this graph is very, very important. Okay. So this is a representation of how your, yes, everyone. So how your things are represented. If you take this competitive inhibition, they are competing, no? With inhibitor and without inhibitor, they are fighting. Yes. So they are fighting, na? So it is represented as X. Right? See here, you can see an X-shaped curve. So no inhibition and with inhibition, it is forming an X-shaped curve. So competition is making an X-shaped curve. Right? So if it is uncompetitive, see, uncompetitive, you know, so it is parallel. So what happens to your uncompetitive? Uncompetitive is parallel. All right. And then if it is going to be your non-competitive, yes, so I usually used to give a clue. Yes, everyone. Yeah, Sony. Come on all. Yes, yes. Yeah, Nivedita. So NV, you remember NV. Non-competitive is V-shaped, right? Okay. Yes, Nivedita. So this is very simple to remember, no? Right. So already I told you that with your competitive alone. Oh, yes, Regen. Thanks a lot. So this competitive alone, your Vmax will be unaffected. We saw, no? Right. But with your uncompetitive and non-competitive, your Vmax is reduced. Okay. Right. And then here in your competitive, your KM is increased. Right? And in your uncompetitive, it is reduced. Absolutely. Yes, yes, Rishali. So they go through the directions only. Absolutely. And then in your this thing uncompetitive, your KM is unaffected. All right, everyone. I hope that this is all clear now. Fine. Very good. Very good all. That's great. Come on. Right. So if it is uncompetitive, it is not going to make any much difference, isn't it? So it is going to still keep on moving. All right. Yes. So what is the best example? Yes. So the best example for your uncompetitive, yes, it is going to be with your methanol. Yes. So the patients, they will be drinking this methanol by mistake. So how do they treat? They add this ethylene glycol. okay, so if at all the patient has drunken this methanol, what it their eyes will go, no? So what they are going to do, they are going to treat them with ethylene glycol. Okay, so this ethylene glycol, it is going to act as an uncompetitive inhibitor. Right, very good. So for your competitive inhibitor, we saw the succinate, malonic acid, succinate dehydrogenase. Here the best example is your methanol ethylene glycol. All right, fine. Yes, everyone. So the next one, it is going to be your non-competitive inhibitor. Yes, so this non-competitive, it is not on your active site, so that is going to be on the unrelated, or it is going to be the other site. Yes, fine. So as far as your non-competitive inhibitor is considered, yes, the best example is cyanide. All the toxic things like your cyanide, right? So cyanide, so immediately the patient will die, isn't it? Right, so that is inhibiting your cytochrome oxidase. Yes, Anjali, absolutely you are correct. So for treating this methanol, for this alcohol dehydrogenase, if at all you are using your ethanol, right, then it becomes your competitive method. So if you use your ethylene glycol, it becomes your other one, isn't it? So if at all you are using your ethanol, it becomes a competitive inhibition. All right, so this cyanide fellow, it is coming under your non-competitive inhibition. All right, fine. So this cyanide poisoning, and then your anti-cancer drugs, so they are all coming under your non-competitive inhibitors, right? So all these inhibitors are very important for your exam. Somehow, no, you have to recollect all those things. All right, see a very very recent 4-mark question. I think this was in June 19 only, not back long back, only last year we had this question. For a reversible, remember the question, for reversible non-competitive inhibition, okay, non-competitive inhibition, right, what you will choose to determine the KM, very directly they are asking, isn't it? Right, so see the option A, option B, option C and option D. So which one you are going to choose for the non-competitive inhibition? Yes, everyone, you are ready with the answers? Yes, I'll give you time if you want. Come on, guys. So which is going to be the correct answer for your non-competitive inhibition? Very good, very good all. Yes, yes. Yes, Anjali, NV, no? Absolutely. Yes, Preeti, Preetam, Srijan, Anjali, Yusef. Absolutely. Very happy for you all. Yes, yes, Nupur. Yes, yes, sir, Balaji. Preeti, Nivedita, Ruchi, Vrishali, Deeksha, Preetam, Yalekni, Nivedita, absolutely. So non-competitive, it is NV, no? 4 marks for this question. Very simple, right? Okay. So if at all it is going to be a competitive, which will be the answer? If it is going to be the competitive, so which is going to be the answer? Yes, Anjali. Yes, yes. So every class we make a trick to remember, na? Yes. So what is this competitive? CX fighter, no? Right, absolutely. So the B could have been the answer, right? So this is competitive. All right, guys. I hope that this is all clear to you. Good. And no? Yes, yes, everyone. So we will make a quick recap of today's class. Yes. So we began with what is an enzyme. Right, and then we just saw what is going to be. Yes, Preetam, Anjali, yes, yes, very good, Vrishali, Nivedita, right, okay. So we began with our enzyme, right? Yes, so enzyme, we just saw the definitionary parts, right? And then we saw what is an apoenzyme, holoenzyme and all, and then we just made a look into your coenzymes, isn't it? So we just saw a table. So if it is going to be your coenzyme A, coca, right, acetyl group. Yes, yes. Sure, Nupur, I will just show you, don't worry. Right, which one? Yes, yes, you want this this table, which one? Yes, all right, which one you want, just let me know, I'll be giving that. Okay, fine. Yes, so all those things we did it today. right? Okay, so this is the total story, right? Okay, so definitely, yes, yes, everyone. Hi, inhibitors, I'll show you, don't worry. Right, and we at Unacademy, we strive hard to give you the best quality material for your preparation. Yes, huh. So this is really going to benefit your preparation a lot. And with Unacademy, you can prepare with for your part A, as well as you can get ready with all your 13 units, right? You will have enough practice, because every month I will be launching this practice MCQ series. We do have a revision series, yes, and then we do have your NTA style test series, mock test, week test, everything you can enroll, and it is all of very less price only. All right, oh yes, thanks a lot, Diksha. So you can learn with this, and you can use my code Saranya Live. Okay, so this code will fetch you a 10% off, right? So you can enroll with for your 12 month program. It will be very beneficial. Yes, if you wish, you can join for 3 months also. Yes, 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 you sir. We'll meet by 8. Yes, Lakini, absolutely. We'll beat Mac by 8 in your plus class, right? So this is the already those students who have got completed their CSER NET. They have given all these testimony for us. All right. And as I told you, with this one subscription, you can get access to all the courses, because like me, many other educators are there. So you will get the access to all the units, right? And you will have the joy of attending live classes, right? So these live classes will give you a better learning. If you sit alone and study, maybe you will be spending 3-4 hours. But with this, in 1 hour only, you can complete the topic. Yes? So these are all the courses that are already completed by me, and this is a current course. So I am teaching unit 13 currently. Yes, and after this 13 is done, we will be moving on into unit 1 and 3, right? So these are all the completed courses. You can check out. Every month I will be launching a practice course, so there you will get a lot and lot of practice MCQ questions, right? So these many courses are already done, right? So 1 month, in the month of Jan, I did with the gate questions. In the month of Feb, I did with your year wise questions, right? And in the month of March, we did it with your unit wise questions. So all these things are available to you. So recorded versions is also there for all these courses. So this will help in your preparation a lot. So try to enroll at the earliest to get your preparation to be completed. All right. Oh yes, everyone. I will catch you up in the next interesting session. Bye bye. Take care. And I will show that inhibitor slide one more time. Somebody was asking for it. Yes. Okay. Yes, Bilob. The class session is almost getting over, Bilob. Yes, yes. Good. So you were asking for that inhibitor. I think this slide, I guess. Class timing, Pushpa. Yes. So the plus classes, I am running it at 8 p.m. Okay. So 8 to 9:30 p.m. I am running the plus classes. All right. Okay. Fine, everyone. That's good. Right. So this is the slide I think you were asking for. All right. Make a note of it. Right. Okay, guys. I think this is all clear. Any other doubts, just ping me. I'll be happy to know. Yes, yes. Yeah, Pushpa. So for plus, the class is at 8 p.m. every day. Okay, right. So the melanoid, you want inhibitor. All right, I'll show it. Don't worry. Yes, everyone. Thanks a lot. This one? Okay, fine. So see here, your succinic acid dehydrogenase, it is the enzyme. Okay. Oh, yes. Yes, Rishali. Okay, right, fine. Yes, yes, absolutely. Yes, Anusha. No. So I am covering 8 units. Okay, so I am covering 8 units. I will be dealing with your biochem, right? And then cell bio, mol bio, developmental biology, and then ecology, evolution, right? Applied biology, methods, right? So these major units I'll be covering. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 units I'm going to cover, right? And my peers, they will be covering up at other units also. All right. Yes, Anisha. Right. So this is the total story. All right. Yes, remaining we have other steps, no? So in English only we are going to begin up with a batch shortly. Okay, so in English, no, many other steps are there in Hindi, right? Oh yes, so thanks a lot, Swaraj. Many steps are there in Hindi. You can check out us at An Academy, right? So in English, very shortly we'll be, no, having the few others. Yes, 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 Anisha, absolutely, right? So we have 20 plus educators in our team. Okay, so everybody is there, so don't worry. All right. Oh yes, everyone, thanks a lot. Yes, meet you next week in YouTube. Yes, Wednesday and Thursday I'll be taking the classes 3 p.m. right? Okay guys, meet you all next week in YouTube. And in the meanwhile, you can enroll with this An Academy Plus and the special classes. All right, so that will be of great help in your preparation. All the best guys. Bye bye.